quite a road trip. I was definitely the oldest person in the band. It was a great festival. We played three different venues. And the performances during the day were almost as long as the after parties. So these guys know how to plan. So that was a lot of fun. And then, like Steve, I made a short trek to go to the bowl yesterday to hopefully graduate from high school.
I have no graduations or newborns to report, but I did travel to meet my teammate that came from Massachusetts to participate in a freshwater national competition at Lake Powell, the Yellowknee Tailwaters. And we had a two-day tournament, and the purpose of our tournament was to qualify the United States and New Zealand next March.
Any other recognitions award for Travis?
Yes.
All right, Bob, that's moving on here. Oh, I should have done that first. So, anniversary is that Tomas and Heidi all had an anniversary. That's
It's actually the 13th, same day as John. Mm-hmm. So, it's not the 13th. You know, we had our son's birthday is the 14th, family was in town for that birthday party. We haven't done much yet, so this weekend, hopefully, we'll get out and get to do something. 9 years together, 18 years, so celebrating 9 years married. We were together for 9 years, took me a while to pop the question.
Congratulations. With John here this morning. He's they had that anniversary as well, same day as I'm last. And then birthdays, Greg here this morning. He's not, and John, they both had birthdays as well, so. When you see them, wish them a happy birthday. They can sing to them anyway, just in case they watch YouTube.
Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday wherever you are. Happy birthday to you.
All right. Being that this is your last meeting, Chris, I was going to say we've come a long way. When you started, it was a few of our birthdays and we didn't even sing and we were here. Now we're singing for people who aren't here.
So if you wanted to mention her, she sent me this picture and wanted to talk a little bit about herself. So,
So last week I had my debunking, my final thing as president, so that was exciting. They gave me that hat with a globe on it and shot glasses. it was a travel theme that I wanted to thank all of you guys again. We probably had about 10 of you. And who's Tom? And Tom? Oh. Thank you, Tom, for letting me use the space. It was a lot of fun. Now
I'm going to be district Voter Representative, Secretary, past
President, and Community Solutions. So my job's not done yet. Wow. So not too much. Yeah. All right.
So, Romy, you
want to
take
the
slide away?
No. Thank you. But anyway, RISE, I do want to mention RISE, because we have a number of newer folks in the club, and RISE, thanks to Ian, was created as a term for when they get together socially. Rotary involvement strengthens everyone. And the more things we do together, the stronger we are as a club. So a really cool RISE event is celebrating the 1 year birthday of the Griffin.
Two year birthday.
The terrible twos.
Exactly.
And so there's going to be music and dancing and fun and two DJs. You want to give us a little update there?
DJ East One and DJ El Boogie, Horn of Bryant from KGCU. They're going to take turns starting at 6.
I just want to jump in and say, one of the great hosts, we've been in your place several times now. And we have every time we go there, it's a special thing. And it's going to be so great to have a good fun night with everybody.
Great food, great cocktails, wonderful venue. Let's all get together and go celebrate Vanessa.
Thursday the 21st.
About what time?
Six.
Okay.
perfect.
Izzy, you made it. That's the president.
Yeah.
Land like we have a lot of reclaimed land in the Netherlands. My home is about 30 feet below sea level.
Wow.
So, but we have good dikes to protect us from water. So, we have good engineers and water management, so I'll be fine for a lot of years. So, and in the Netherlands, I met him at the NIAID, so that's why we got involved with each other. And it's really nice just being here and as a chair responsible for the youth exchange in the Netherlands, I really hope that we're going to have maybe a work club to educate, who knows, in the future. So, thank you very much. So,
thank you.
Any other general announcements before we move on? Oyster Fest is tomorrow, so if you want to call or sign up, you can just show up or give me an email or whatever and make it happen. So without further ado, our guest speaker today is Justin McDonald. Do you want to give an introduction?
Well, Justin's returning to give us a little report on how things are going at the fire department. I wanted to give a little background on him. He's a fifth generation Humboldter, and his family has been involved in the Arcata Fire Department for decades, from back when the forces were all, it was all volunteers, to now when it's pretty much a hated 50-50. He joined in 94 and became a paid firefighter in 2001. Since 2010, he's been a part of the administrative team. In 2009, he got his Bachelor of Science from California State Long Beach in occupational studies. And he's continued his training and just recently received his fire chief's training state level. It's a state training. And he lives in McKinleyville with his wife Holly and three boys, 14, 16, and 18. And his daughter Kelsey is attending College of Veterinary Medicine at Ohio State. And I guess she has one more year to go. Congratulations. Thank you for coming.
No problem.
So I have to say, the last time I came, I made a pitch for a new board member, and it worked. So we got Randy on board shortly thereafter. So this is good, and I failed to run my PowerPoint presentation through my boss. So hopefully, you know, this month I'm getting my evaluation. So hopefully, thumbs up. This is good. If not, I'm getting a demerit. First, I want to say thanks for, especially to this club, for the many years of support. And these two pictures are a prime example of what our partnership has been for, well, since probably around 94. I came in as a 19-year-old kid, didn't know anything better, but we were fundraising and teamed up with Rotary shortly thereafter. And my entire career through volunteer leaning into the paid part, we were talking about building fire stations, and then wham, all of a sudden we did, and I'm thinking, okay, for 20 years we talked about building fire stations, and now what are we going to talk about? So, if you have a chance, please come by. We try to do an open house at Arcata every year in October, and the last couple of years we've been doing an open house in McKinleyville at Pony Express Days. We've had huge success with bringing people through to check it out, so we're pretty proud of it. You guys should be too. Please stop by. Thank you again. Just real quick about what we are, and two things I want to highlight is our mission. We exist to protect the lives, environment, and property, and the communities we serve. This is a little bit different than most fire service because the environment is kind of third tier. We live in Humboldt County. We value the environment. That's kind of a priority for us. And I want to point out that the communities, I have a different philosophy. My philosophy is it's not Arcata, it's not McKinleyville, it's not Bayside. It's the communities. And we're all part of a bigger team. So when Blue Lake, Fieldbrook need help, we send a crew out there. I have friends, I have family that live outside our fire district. So I think it's really important that as a larger fire district in the county, we help our little neighbors. So the communities we serve is generic, because last summer, as I'll get here in a minute, we went to Ventura County, we went to Napa County. You know, we had family from, some of our employees had family down in Ventura County, so it's kind of a big thing. Every effort, every hour, every call was something our crew came up with. We had a value statement. It was probably 10 items, and each was a sentence, and nobody would remember it. I said, well, if I can't remember it as a fire chief, then that's a problem. And so I kicked it back to our crew, and they came up with this pretty simple thing that everybody can remember. The nice part about it is they designed it, they bought into it, I'm just a champion of it. And it doesn't have, you know, integrity and honesty and all this other stuff. That's what everybody individually brings to the organization. Overarching our organization, we'll put every effort, every hour, because we're 24 hours a day, to every call. Whether it's an incident, somebody calls up and needs assistance, we'll be there for them. Who are we? We're a small group. I would say we're woefully understaffed as far as the national standard, even the state standard. Every day, Monday through Friday, it's me and Becky, my business manager, that runs the kind of the business side of the house. And then we have 21 career staff that are split up on three shifts. Do the math, that's six firefighters on duty and one chief officer covering our entire fire district. We have 15 volunteers. It ebbs and flows. And then we have a new group, logistics members. These are community members that want to help out, but don't want to go fight fire. I tell you what, it was one of these things that was pitched to me back when I was assistant chief. We rolled with it. These logistics members help us with traffic control. The biggest thing they do is when we have a fire, they're right in the second seat, they're taking notes, they're answering the radio for us, and it's huge. And these folks are all excited to be part of it. So it's a very valuable thing for us. The other side of it is we're looking at trying to increase our quote-unquote volunteers. We're looking to recruit student interns, maybe a graduate from fire academies. Problem is, most of the fire academies are over the valley. Nobody really wants to do a 4-hour, 6-hour drive from the Bay Area to come up. But we have some interest. We sent out a couple of our folks to do a recruitment fair, and we're trying to get that kicked off. So we're trying to increase our volunteer group. We operate three stations. As you saw, two stations, Arcata and Kennedale, and then the used to be the newest station, now it's actually the oldest station, next to the hospital. We are an independent special district. What that means is I don't answer to the Board of Supervisors. I have an independent 5-member board, Randy's on it, and they give me direction and they answer to you guys as the community the Arcata Fire District. We're 62 square miles, 37,000 residents. We are the second largest special district in the county. We're second to the Harbor District. Everybody else is pretty much a small fire district or community services district for a smaller county. So in population and in square miles. As I said, we cover Arcata, McKinneyville, Bayside, and Manila. Those are all of our areas. I was afraid of that. I was playing with this on my computer at home and noticed that. So that's our pie chart where our money goes from. So luckily on my notes, this big one right here, this is our tax revenue. And our tax revenue is based on an ad valorem. And it's a complicated thing, and as much as I can simplify it, the county assesses your property. For every $100 of assessed value, the county takes $1 and we receive 7 cents. So you can do the math on some of those properties out there. It's not a lot, but it helps. We do also have a special tax, and it's about $300,000 in special tax. The biggest share that we get is this orange one, and that's our benefit assessment, which was passed in about 2006. And that's $1.7 million. This slice right here, other revenues, it's grants, interest money on county treasury, donations, proceeds from sales of excess equipment, and our summertime fire response. And then this little bit right here is our charge for service, which I'll get into that. That's about $96,000. And then the last little sliver is transfers from reserves, and that was about 23,000. So that's what we're projecting for the fiscal year 2018-19. Where does it all go? Just like any government entity, most of it goes out to employee salary and benefits. $3.4 million goes out in salaries and benefits. 15% is services and supplies, and we have debt service, which is the fire engine loan that we have. There's two loans combined in the one that we bought five fire engines over the last about decade now. And we had until 2021 came off. In the grand scheme of things, this looks pretty wonky, 80%, but I would say in most other agencies, that number is close to 90% where it goes into salaries and benefits. I've been making this pitch to our crew to understand where their money comes from and how it gets into their paycheck. And they understand that the lion's share of the operating costs of the fire district is the people at the station. So it's important to let the community know, but it's also important to keep our employees up to date with that. What did we do last year? We had another record-breaking year, 3,155 calls. As you can see, rescue EMS are roughly half of what we do. When you call 911, you need an ambulance, we go. And some people go, why does the fire department go on EMS calls? You could save money by not going on EMS calls. Sure. Realize, there's only two ambulances that cover from Indianola north to the county line. Two. And there's three ambulances that cover the city of Eureka, two that cover Fortuna. That's what you have in Humboldt County. We used to be really lucky where we didn't wait for ambulances here in Arcata. The ambulance right around the corner, they were hot on our trail. McKinleyville, a little bit, because Arcata's busier, they would pull their second ambulance in. We are now waiting for ambulances in McKinleyville, sometimes 3-4 minutes. We are also waiting for ambulances in Arcata because they are getting so busy. So I'll ask you, when you call 911, you're having a heart attack, you're having a diabetic emergency, you want to wait 3, 4, 5 minutes for the ambulance to show up? I guarantee you the answer is no. You will have us show up, we'll start rendering care, and we'll wait for the ambulance. So it's important. We are here. Ambulances tend to be more mobile, driving between hospitals. And that's why you have all the fire departments that roll out on EMS calls. Out in the rural areas like Fieldbrook and further out, they even go out on code 2 calls because it takes, using jargon, code 2 calls, non-emergency. Non-emergency calls, fire department will go out so that they get somebody to get to your event to start rendering care. And if anything, it's just to say, hey, we're here to help, ambulance is on the way, and that also just kind of calms the patient down. So we do 6% of the rest of the pie is fires, and that means everything else. And service calls, good intent calls, I'll put it in simplistic terms. And I know Randy's a police officer, retired, if anybody else is, I apologize. Whatever the cops don't want to do, whatever the ambulance can't do, it comes to us. We short of getting the cat out of the tree, we don't do that. But we've helped people where their fish tank blew up, water goes everywhere, we can go out and help kind of suck up the water. We had a lady in McKinleyville that had an issue with her washing machine, blew water everywhere. We sent crews out there. The biggest thing I'd like to say, we're not just fire, we are creative problem solvers. If you have a problem that you can't deal with, give us a call. We'll at least come out and help or get you pointed in the right direction. But that makes up that other portion of the calls that we go out to. So what did we do last year? First and foremost is I really kicked up district transparency. And I know that's kind of a big buzz in government right now, but there was some laws that were passed just recently that required us to be more transparent. So we jumped in. All of our financial information and our audits are all posted on our webpage. If anybody wants copies of them, you know, we can pretty thick, so I can't really email it to you, but we can get it. But they're on the webpage. Anybody can see what we're doing. We did have a PERS audit. It took over year to get it completed, and everybody knows PERS, that's our retirement system. PERS came back and said, hey, you've got 7 issues that you need to correct. It was pretty epic. We battled back and forth with PERS. We won a couple of rulings on our side, and we had to fix some others. They were pretty good to work with. But the biggest thing I like to tell folks is we corrected issues that we didn't know that we were doing it wrong. So it's okay to be wrong, it's not okay to stay wrong. And the biggest thing is I don't want to find myself in a lawsuit down the road when an employee says, hey, you didn't do my retirement correctly. So we worked with PERS, we got ourselves situated. It just kind of unfortunately fell at the same time that I became chief and Becky became the business manager with me. So we were like really green, jumped into this, and PERS says, hey, here's your audit, now fix it. I'm like, well, it's not good. The other thing I'd like to highlight is cross-staffing. Last time I came here, we talked about how we were trying this new thing, cross-staffing our pickup trucks. And it was ironic because as I was making my sales pitch to Randy to be a board member, the pickup truck shot up G Street to go on a call. I said, that's what I'm talking about. Okay, so we've done it for a year, and I'm happy to say that we've seen out of this station, Arcata's dropped mileage on the fire engine by 35%. The Killeville station dropped by 29%. So we're saving mileage on the fire engines and we're going to run the pickup trucks. It was a little weird. The crews were like, but my fire engine, I need to be ready. Okay, here's the fire chief's philosophy. When you call 911, you're our most important incident. Not what may happen. That's the what if. You know, and I'll highlight it with what I've told my crew. Every day you see 747, well, not anymore, 737, 767s flying over, going to Japan. Do we worry that thing's going to fall out of the sky and land right here in our fire district? No. It's a what if. Well, what if a fire happens? Then we deal with it. We have mutual aid from our neighbors. We have other fire engine staff ready to go. You deal with the call that comes in. 911, what's your emergency? We'll come out and we'll help. That is our priority. So don't worry about the next, let's worry about now. And so we're driving pickup trucks. We're taking them to lipases, we're taking them to medical aids. It's working, so now I'm looking for grants to put a mini pump in the back of the pickup trucks and carry a little bit of water, so if they do happen to catch a fire, they got 100, 200 gallons of water to make a difference. But the pickup trucks have the air tanks that they can go into a fire. It has tools that they can force entry in the doors. And it has fire extinguishers, which I've put out plenty of fire with our 2.5 gallon water extinguishers. So they're set. There was some apprehension. It's not cool and sexy to drive around in a pickup truck. It is in a fire engine. But after a year, I can say we've dropped the mileage by a third. So it'll extend out those fire engine. Relationships. Part of my task when I became fire chief, the board says you need to play nice with your neighbors. Got it. So we started off with this campaign to do some interagency training between other fire agencies. We had Fieldbrook and Blue Lake. We hosted them on a auto extrication class. We've been trying to coordinate our volunteer drill night with other agencies. So I'm hopeful that this next year we'll have the same drill training for all of our neighbors and us. So if a Fieldbrook volunteer can't make it to their night, they can come to our night, they get the credit. Our guys, if they can't make ours, they can go out to Blue Lake, Fieldbrook, or Samoa. So that's been huge. We've entered into what's called auto aid agreements with all of our neighbors. So anytime we have a fire event, you're gonna see other fire engines, not just Arcata, coming to the incident. We don't have the staffing, 6 people on duty, and a hope that volunteers show up is not a way to put out fires. So we have to rely on Blue Lake and Fieldbrook and Samoa, Humble Bay, even Cal Fire up in Trinidad to come to help us with fires. So there's about 3 agencies besides us that will show up to, depending on where you are, to a fire. The other thing, we've strengthened our relationship with law enforcement. It used to be law and fire were different, you know, red, blue, they didn't really mix well. And it's kind of forced it with this active shooter thing. So university police has developed what's called a criminal mass casualty incident. It's when somebody goes berserk and we have a bunch of people down and what do you do? In the old days, fire used to stand by and wait until it was safe. people die, and that's not good. So now we're working with law enforcement to have law enforcement protect us. We go in and try to pull people out. The bad guy could be, you know, maybe in a different room or a different floor. It's outside the box. But I'm happy to say, between University and Arcata, we're leading the charge here in the county, and it's taken off. So this plan that we developed, the North Bay plan with Arcata PD, University, and Arcata Fire, has now ripple effect gone out. So the Law Enforcement Chief Officers Association is adopting the same plan. And I just got elected into being the County Fire Chiefs Association President, and we're adopting that plan. So countywide, something that started here in the Arcata area has blossomed out to all other agencies. So I'd like to say, you're taking notes on my evaluation. We did it. Okay, good. One other thing that we took off after I became the chief, and again, some of this stuff I didn't realize the benefits until after the fact, was our organizational playbook. We had a rule book, probably 3 inches thick, and we threw it out. Yeah, okay, we got some rules that we have to do, the federal rules and the state rules. But there was stuff, when to put up the flag, when to clean the toilets, I mean, it was like, okay, come on, people, this is ridiculous. Somebody screwed up, we got a policy with somebody's name on it, and don't ever do that again. So we threw it out. And we came up with this concept, organizational playbook. And essentially, it's not the rule book, you're not going to get disciplined, but it's how to be an adult. It's how to get along with your coworkers. It's how to do the right thing when the boss is not looking. And it's taken off. You know, we're probably about 80% people buy in on it.
Do you sell copies of that?
Do I sell copies? It works on teenagers, too.
That would be good.
So, you know, I'm happy to say that it's, it even says in the playbook, if you have to break the rules to do the right thing, break the rule. You know, we had a policy of you don't get in the water. The Mad River's pretty swift. We had a day that there was a guy that he actually broke his neck, and we would have spent 4 hours building this rope rescue system, pulling him up. And the guy that was on duty that day was a former lifeguard from Orange County, and the captain on the engine said, "Look, there's kids swimming in the water right there. We're gonna swim him across the river. That is a violation of our rules. Period. Don't get wet." And afterwards, they were all scared to death that I was gonna write them up and, you know, have a disciplinary action. And I said, "You did the right thing. The last thing I need is somebody on YouTube going, 'Please, dumb firemen, they can't get this person, and there's kids swimming in the water.'" I said, "The only thing is, next time, tie a rope to somebody. So if something happens, you got them. That's it." I said, "Yeah, you did the right thing. You broke the rules, but, you know, good job. Nobody got hurt." The last thing is revenue recovery implementation. We got a lot of feedback. When Measure A failed, we didn't get our funding. They said, you know, live within your means, try to find other sources of revenue. Well, we did. Revenue recovery, we're going after insurance companies for car accidents. And, you know, it's not a lot of money. It's not going to solve budget crisis, but it's something. The other thing is we're charging for plan checks. We were one of the last agencies that didn't charge for these fire prevention fees. These fire prevention fees, apartment complexes were mandated every year to go out and inspect it. I have a part-time inspector. The fees pay for his position, so it's kind of a cost-neutral thing. So we're trying every avenue. I know tax dollars are tight, and we've got to try to stretch out what we have and make for it. The last thing I have is fire season. We talked about the, you know, other communities. We went to Napa County when they had their big wind event, the fire that blew through. We sent an engine down there. They were down there for about 5 days doing patrolling and mop-up. We also had an engine go as part of a local strike team, 5 engines. The chief officer went to Ventura County. They were down there for 2 weeks. I was getting really nervous. It was fire season supposed to be over September. That was in December. I was worried that we were going to have crews down there over Christmas. Luckily, they all came home. It's one of those pay it forward. Like I said, our firefighter, his mom lives in Ventura. House was threatened. She wasn't answering the phone. Our firefighter union called their firefighter union, who said, "No, we had an engine go out there. The house is still standing. Everything's good." He was pretty stressed out after that. He was calm. 24 hours later, we got a request for the engine to go. Anthony was on the engine to go pay it back. He went down there to his hometown. The ironic part, that fire engine had a kid from Orange County, a kid from Ventura County, a kid from LA County, a And then the captain on the engine was a local kid, so. But it was really weird that everybody that went south was from that area, so it was really neat. The great part is, it really was a shot in the arm to the district. We net $385,000 in fees paid back to us by the state of California for going out there. The other hot topic is Major Z. What did we get? Well, first couple of years, we got nothing. That's a misnomer. First couple of years, we got nothing directly to the fire department, but we got in benefit. Fieldbrook, Blue Lake, Samoa, everybody that comes to play for us, they got brand new gear, they got brand new air packs, and some of them even got brand new, well, used fire engines. We get that as an indirect benefit because crews coming to our fire agency had good equipment, reliable equipment, air packs that were up to standard, and that makes it safer for you guys as the community if they have to go in and perform a rescue or firefighting. Last year, we were able to secure 37 air bottles. That's what that is right there. An air bottle holds about 45 minutes on a good day, 15 if you're working hard, 15 minutes in air. It also picked up $62,500 worth of dispatch fees, and I did the math, and we were $200 off, so it paid for all of our dispatch fees for 2007. And five sets of PPE, which is personal protective equipment, that's the gear that the firefighters wear to go with the fire out. In 2018, we put in a bigger request. The last 2 years, it was determined at the Fire Chiefs Association level that it would take care of the bigger departments, Humboldt Bay and us. We're going to get 22 more air bottles, again, dispatch fees. One thing I'm really excited for is a mobile training tower. We don't have a place to park a fixed tower like Humboldt Bay has. So it's this kind of a fifth wheel that the tower tilts up and a burn trailer that goes with it. Because it's Major Z, we've said any agency that needs to borrow it will tow it to their agency and they can use it as well. We got 56 of those coming and 5 to 10 sets more of the structure here. So we're getting it. Hopefully Major Z keeps going. I don't have a good idea of where it's going to be, but we definitely have benefit. All of the county fire agencies have benefited from it. Where do we go? Present, future concerns. Volunteers. It's not a unique problem for us. It's regional, it's actually nationwide, that we're seeing a decline in volunteer firefighters. And real quick, I pulled some stats from the National Volunteer Firefighter Council. It's declined 15% from an all-time high in 1984 to an all-time low in 2011. And on the flip side, call volume has increased 300% nationwide over that. So people that want to volunteer dropping, and the demand for services is going up. We're seeing it here as well. I know Blue Lake, Fieldbrook, Samoa, all of our neighbors that rely on volunteers are also seeing it. It's harder and harder. And why is that? Because OSHA and state fire training doesn't care whether you get a paycheck or not. You have to meet the same training standards. And nobody has time for that. It's pretty outlandish. Our recruitment academy for volunteers is over 200 hours. And as the chief risk management officer for the agency, I can't have people that are not trained and ready to go out there providing the firefighter service, so it's pretty hard. We have about a 1.5 year lifespan on a volunteer. They get in all gung-ho, we get them trained up, and then we're like, whoa, this is way too much time. I don't like getting out of bed in the middle of the night. And it takes about 3 years to get a return on investment. So we're trying everything we can to streamline the process, get the training down to the absolute minimum to make them a valuable team player, but not overload them with everything else. Our career staff, we're behind the Redwood Curtain. We have currently a recruitment in process for one vacant position. It's a pretty decent job. We sent out 900 emails to Fire Academy grads that met the minimum requirements. We received 11 applications. 9 RSVP'd and 5 actually showed up for the interview. That's pathetic. It's good for the 5 that did. Your odds are really good. Conversely, in the Bay Area, one of our firefighters left because he could get more money. He actually, as a firefighter, makes as much as I do. To be just the ride backwards and take orders firefighter. It was in Milpitas. They received, I don't know how many, I think the application was open for 10 minutes. They received 800, and then they interviewed 800 applicants to take the positions down there. So I can't compete, but what I can offer is we're a small group, we're close-knit, and the extra activities that we do within our organization are pretty good with the collateral beauty dogs. But just one of those things, you know, I know we get beat up over fat cat government employees, wages and benefits, but it's one of those things to attract employees. It's super, super hard. And the other side of it is, if you don't find a local person, then they have a tendency to want to go back to where they came from and get a job. My goal is to find them a spouse, and then they get angry. And then nobody's going anywhere. And then so, increased call volume, growth of the district is kind of the same thing. As infill, as people are moving in, it creates more of a demand. The call volume goes up. Just to show, last year we saw an 8% increase. What does that mean? That's a weird, you know, 8% of what? That's 226 more calls than the year prior. That is 1 month of calls. So we essentially ran 13 months worth of calls in a 12-month span. Every year we see that similar increase, about 100 to 150 calls every year. You know, we're gonna hit that point where we're just not keeping up. And that's not just us. Across the Bay, we did, 3,100? They're over 6,000 calls in the whole Bay jurisdiction. And because we rely on our neighbors, Millbrook's call volume has increased as well. We hit them, come help us. And then, like I said, we talk about our tax. I get really limited where I can get my income from, the ad valorem, the special tax, benefit assessment, fees for service, and that's it. So future planning, what do we need? What do we need from our community? And that is input. Okay, we can lock ourselves in our conference room and think of all the coolest ways to increase our service and decrease our service. That doesn't mean anything. You're the customers, you're the direct recipients. So we need to hear from you folks on service delivery expectations, any help on funding avenues. If you have an inkling to volunteer, or if you have any ideas on how that we can recruitment, especially retention, we'd be interested to hear that. The other part, these are kind of buzzwords, but I think they're really important. Regionalization, consolidation, and shared services. I read a report from LAFCO. The report was older than I was, but it talked about the Mid-County Fire District, and that was merging fire districts together so you don't have this redundancy of five fire chiefs and reserve fire equipment and all of that. It's a concept. And I think you're going to see more of it. The other thing is attend our board meetings. We have zero public come to our board meetings. You know, I guess that's okay. We're not doing anything wrong. When we do something wrong, the whole place is filled. But, you know, we need Randy needs input. He works really hard. He asks a lot of questions on behalf of you guys. Community. So if you don't want to come to our board meeting, which I don't blame you, contact your elected officials. Randy and Elena David and David Rosen is our new rep for the Jacoby Creek Manila area. He's the CFO out of United Indian Health. They're your southern representatives. Just because you don't live in their district doesn't mean anything. You can call them. We have Nicole Johnson, who was appointed last month. She is the South McKinneyville rep, and then Renee Campbell is up in the north. So our five elected officials, their emails are on our webpage. Feel free to contact them if you have any questions or concerns. If I'm not doing my job correctly, but that's all I have. If you have questions, yes.
When and where are your board meetings?
The third Tuesday night, 5:30 at the Arcata Fire Station. Yes?
It's hard to fathom that you can't attract talent. I think your slide said
your payroll costs and benefits was $3.5 million. Of what portion of that is the contribution to PERS?
The contribution, okay, so we pay for every dollar in wages, we're paying $1.10 in PERS and health insurance and all the other. So.
And in public safety, how many years does somebody need to work to retire and get their PERS?
It's a sliding scale. So PERS, you have to be vested for 5 years, but you don't get 100%. So in our industry, in the safety side of it, you would have to work roughly 25, 30 years, especially for the newer folks. They tiered out the system. You have a minimum retirement age of 50, but it has to do with how many years of service. So if you're 50 and you have 5 years, you're only going to get 15% of the retirement.
And that $3.5 million covers your position, the business manager, and was it 16 paid people?
The total, it was 21 career employees plus me plus the business manager. We do have a couple part-timers.
23.5 for 4 people,
$3.5 million. Yeah, so PERS is, we're a small agency in PERS, and as the PERS revenues go up and then they go back down, we're kind of on a 3 year slack behind it. When the economy tanked and PERS was all of a sudden went underfunded, they hit us pretty hard, and we had to go back and pay retroactive for past employees to make that difference up. And you know, I can't speak to the past. It was past administrations that agreed to it. It was also PERS that I think was playing some games that allowed agencies to change their retirements. Unfortunately, I'm stuck holding the bag. And, you know, we've got this year alone a $360,000 payment to PERS just to hit that break-even point. So that's part of our elected officials' push this year when we go into wage negotiations, is to really ratchet back where we cap out stuff. And, you know, and that's what I'm telling our employees. This is it.
That's not going to help your recruitment efforts.
No.
Do you think anybody at the academy told them that 6% of their calls would be fires?
No.
I mean, that may be part of it. I mean, if they think they're going to be riding around on a fire truck all day long and it's 6%, and nobody told them that.
And our call volume in fire is higher. You know, we seem to have a structured fire probably once or twice a month. We read this a little higher. You go down to the Bay Area, it's not even that high. They're way lower than that. So yeah, the bad side is we're the only ones that fight fire, whereas an EMS call, law enforcement can be a first responder, ambulance transports you, but I mean, the service that we provide is we're the only ones that put the fire out, and that's the tough part.
I'm curious about what your workers' comp rate, what do you guys pay?
So we belong to the county workers' comp. We actually, we're blended into the bigger system, and we are paying right around, I want to say, $37,000 for workers' comp.
What percentage? I mean, what is the percentage of wages? Is it like 25, 30%?
That's a good question. We get the bill from the county. We have to put in a percentage of our payroll, and it also includes volunteers. Volunteers, I think around $250 annually for each position that we cover. We were with another fire district workers' comp plan, and it reduced, by going with the county, it reduced it by 50%. The downside is we're stuck with the county system and kind of a slower process to get our employees back.
How has your liaison with law enforcement changed your training needs?
Say that again.
How has your liaison with law enforcement changed your training needs?
It's actually improved our training. So we're into what's called the incident command system. It's kind of like a military model on how to manage who's in charge. And so we're working with law enforcement closer upon that. When we do these trainings with law enforcement, especially the active shooter, we kind of have them reverse roles. Sometimes law enforcement will act as firefighters to see what we're going through. We'll do the same thing, go shadow a police officer. And it just kind of highlights the fact that when we do this active shooter situation, we need to have our police escort. You can't just leave us alone and go run off and go find the bad guys. So it's really, it's strengthened the relationship between the two, law enforcement and fire, so that we work closer together.
So how do some of your folks feel about being maybe put in that kind of a role that's not necessarily traditionally fire duties?
So we have it big bold letters. It's if you don't feel safe, you don't do it. So if bullets are winging by and you say, this is not what I signed up to do, you have that option out. And that's first and foremost, that right of refusal. We just have to put it in there because firefighters didn't sign up to get, you know, shot at. But we also signed up to save lives. And so somewhere in the middle, we have to make that call. And that's kind of a personal call.
So do you think that hampers your recruiting?
No, not on that side. The biggest thing I think is the pay.
Well, we're talking about the value of a firefighter and the cost of putting them out on the street. One of the things that we've got to consider is the health aspect and the cost to each one of these guys health-wise. Some of the statistics on that might help.
That's true. I don't have that statistic off the top of my head, but I do know that we're seeing an increase in PTSD. We thought that used to be kind of a military thing. As the call volume is increasing, the old timers ran the same calls, probably worse. But their calls were, you know, when I joined, the call volume was 600 calls a year. And so you had time to decompress, and now we're seeing the same things over and over. I know Humboldt Bay has actually retired out at least one, if not two, people on stress. It just finally, it was too much, you can't take it, you lose your edge, you can't do the job. So that's a new thing, and then the other thing is cancer's killing us. You know, we don't have that all encapsulated suit, gets on our skin. We have a process that after fire, we have baby wipes that we're wiping off all of our exposed skin to try to minimize that cancer. But we're losing firefighters nationwide to stomach cancer, throat cancer, lung cancer.
There's a blood drive tomorrow, Battle of the Badges. If you donate on the across the street from the fire station, you can either tell them Arcata PD or the fire department. See who gets more donors.
We've won 2 years in a row.
So if you give me 10 minutes after the debunking, I can do the special recognitions there, but we don't have time today to do it. So I just want to then close with a thank you to everybody for everything you did. The whole year it's been an honor to serve as your president. It's an experience I'll never forget, and I hope you all found this year to be fun and engaging and inspiring as well. So with that, I will leave you with my last quote of the year from one of my favorite musicians and someone that did it my way.